Risk is an essential part of doing business, whether it's taking a risk on a merger or acquisition, taking a risk that purchasing new equipment will be a cost-effective investment, or whether there's sufficient plant protection to avoid injuries to workers. Management needs to understand their level of risk exposure and make sure that it's within their risk appetite. Cybersecurity is, at its heart, the management of risk related to internet-connected businesses. This includes the threats of hackers and malicious software entering from the internet, the vulnerabilities of internet-facing IT systems, and the attack countermeasures or controls, all of which affect how successful the business will be in meeting its desired outcomes. A standard approach to managing risk has been developed by the National Institute of Standards and Technology, and its application is described in Special Publication 830, Guide for Conducting Risk Assessments. The International Standards Organization also provides guidance with its ISO 27005 Information Security Risk Management publication. While there are minor terminology differences, the intent of both documents is the same. Risk starts with a threat event, which must be analysed to determine the likelihood that the event will occur. This is done by considering the likely threat actors, their capabilities, and their resources. The intent or motivation needs to be considered. What is it that drives this threat actor to want to mount an attack? An attacker will only attack if the results outweigh the cost of attacking, and that depends on the value of the target to the threat actor. This could be financial gain, obtaining intelligence, disrupting services, or just peer recognition. The next thing to think about is the set of vulnerabilities in the information and processing assets, the databases, workstations, servers, and networks, which this event can exploit to cause damage. For instance, a data center in the basement of a building may be vulnerable to a flood event. A website may have a software vulnerability which can be exploited. A server without an uninterruptible power supply would be vulnerable to a power outage. However, not all vulnerabilities are equal. A flood may be catastrophic, with the whole data center out of action for weeks, whereas an attack which exploits a website flaw may just be a nuisance. The next thing to consider is the impact to the business of an event. This is typically done by carrying out a business impact assessment to determine what systems will be affected, how this flows on to business processes, and the cost of service degradation or failure to meet critical levels of performance. Being able to describe a security event as a business impact is a powerful way of gaining the attention and the respect of the business, and being able to get a well-balanced business decision on what to do about the threat. Controls may have been put in place to protect the asset, and their effectiveness needs to be considered for each of the feasible threat scenarios. This will then allow calculation of the overall risk. The Cybersecurity Risk Management Program starts with sourcing threat intelligence. Let's have a look at some of the sources of threat intelligence. A useful catalogue of threats can be found at Appendix E to the NIST Special Publication SP 830. This catalogue provides representative examples of threat events expressed as tactics, techniques, and procedures, or TTPs. Another very useful source of TTPs is the MITRE attack site, which is used in MITRE's Cybersecurity Resiliency Framework. Veris provides an open community threat database, which can be used to support risk analysis. ThreatStream offers an open source cyber intelligence blog, which reports on contemporary activities and threat actors. There are a number of good sources of specific threat reports which provide detailed information on threat actors, threat techniques, and target vulnerabilities. Here we see a report from BAE Systems Applied Intelligence on a vulnerable application called MacKeeper that can be exploited to attack macOS systems. There are four possible treatments once an assessment has identified the risk. Risk acceptance, where the risk is within the business's appetite. Risk avoidance, where it's better to stop doing that line of business than take the risk. Risk transfer, where a third party takes the risk, such as insurance to cover risk, should it eventuate. And risk mitigation, where controls are implemented to reduce risk. Risk mitigation and the protection of business outcomes which they provide means implementing controls in the form of cybersecurity policies, procedures, and technical solutions. There are four key types of control that can be applied, and it's generally recommended that two or more are used together to achieve defense in depth. The first is deterrent controls. These reduce the threat. An example of this is incarceration, which deters would-be criminals from carrying out their attacks. Preventative controls are designed to stop the attack from succeeding by not allowing it to get at an asset to exploit a vulnerability. A firewall is one such preventative control, blocking protocols that might be used as attack vectors. Detective controls are used to detect that an attack has taken place. A burglar alarm is a typical detective control. Finally, corrective controls are used to reduce the impact of an incident, a good example of this being recovery from data backups. The NIST Cybersecurity Framework presents corrective controls as the respond and recover functional controls.